Hi, my name is Jim Hockaday. I've been in ministry now for over 25 years, and the thoughts that I bring to you will actually show some of the history of my life. And so briefly, for a moment, I want to share with you some questions that actually take me back into 1994. Questions that revolved around, am I really experiencing what I know in my heart that I should experience concerning my relationship with God? Are my prayers being answered? Now that's a big one. Am I getting the results that I should? So back in 1994, I was involved with a ministry, a very large ministry in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and I was privileged to do the prayer school and healing school, where basically I taught, let's just say, 3-4 times a day. Now I'm teaching most of the time to those that are sick. And at those beginning months, let's just say the first 3 months, we saw more people die than we did get healed. Now, certainly you can't advertise that, but really what it turned out to be is more of a hospice home than it was a healing center. It had become over the years a place of teaching, but not a place of demonstration. So I had to ask myself real questions. In fact, this is one of the things you're going to hear in the sessions that we have following, because this is session 1 of 8 sessions. And that is, are you willing to ask yourself the big questions? In other words, questions that bring you to a place of recognizing that you need something else, that you're wrong, that you're not experiencing what you should experience, and you're willing to do whatever it takes to get those answers met. Well, back in those early years and those early months of doing prayer school and healing school for a period of 10 years, from 1994 to 2004, I had to ask those questions. And what you're about to hear are some of the results of the things that God began to share me, because what I did was I said to the Lord, it's not your fault, it's not the fault of the people, it has to be me that's the problem, so you have to reinvent me, even if it means the things that I've learned from so many credible people, I'm willing to lay them down and have you teach me all over again. And what this became, folks, is what I want to introduce to you. It became one of the greatest things that I've ever done in my life. It became the point of humbling, or the point of repentance, where God's grace began to take over and began to share things with me, and immediately we began to see the miraculous taking place in people's lives. Well, I want to share with you some thoughts here this morning as we go over to John chapter 4 and verse 23 and 24. And I'll also let you know what translation that we're reading out of. And this is the New King James Version. So let's talk about being a spirit being. This may sound foreign to you. It's very possible some of you that are listening to me right now are questioning in your mind, what is a spirit being? Well, let's discover that. It says right here, and this is Jesus speaking, but the hour is coming and now is when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship Him, for God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth. Now, you can't get any more specific, right to the point here, where Jesus is relaying to everybody, if you're going to contact God, who is a spirit, you have to do it out of your spirit. So I have to pose the first question to you, and that is, how are you going to contact God who is a spirit if you don't know that you are a spirit? Let's go a little bit further. How are you going to contact God who is a spirit if you're not in any type of connection with your own spirit? You say, well, I'm losing a little bit of traction here because I don't understand what this talk is about a spirit. Well, let's go a little further here and look at the same verse of Scripture, but in a different translation called the Message Translation. And I'll begin reading. Again, Jesus is speaking here. It's who you are and the way you live that count before God. Now, folks, I don't want to take a lot of time with this, but this is going to be the subject of so much that's going to take place in the sessions beyond this first session. Remember, this is session 1 of 8 sessions. It's who you are, the way you live, that count before God. In other words, the reality that you have created in your life. You say, well, I haven't created any reality. Oh, yes, you have. What you've accepted to be real in your life, your patterns, your habits, the way you do life, is the way you will do faith. I'm going to say that again. The way you do life, which means the way you see your life, the way you see reality, is the way you're going to do faith. And if your faith in God isn't working, you're not seeing answers, it goes back to the world you've created, or it goes back to the way you do life. Now let's look at what Jesus says here, because what he says next is an amazing and wonderful thought. It says, your worship must engage your spirit in the pursuit of truth. Well, when I learned to drive a vehicle, it was quite a few years ago. And the vehicle that I learned to drive, this will date me a little bit, but it was a Ford Maverick, three on the tree, we used to call it. You had to engage, use the clutch. I know there's not many automatic, most of the cars are automatic today, not many manual drive cars. But this was where you had to use the clutch and you had to shift the car. Maybe that doesn't sound foreign to some of you, but to many of you, you don't have a clue what I just said. Well, we had to engage that car, put it into gear in order for it to go. In the neighborhood I grew up in, the really only way to get to some of the major city areas was to go up this hill. And it used to be a panic in my heart. I'd used to think to myself, if I could tell everybody behind me, don't get near me, I'm learning how to drive, and I'm learning how to drive on a stick shift. I've got to engage the clutch. Because I burned more rubber on that hill just making sure that I went forward and didn't go backwards. I'm only using this example to show you that this is exactly what we must do with God and our worship. In other words, I had a clutch and I had gears, but if I didn't engage the car into a gear, it wasn't going to move forward. You are a spirit, but whether or not you engage your spirit in the pursuit of worship, you're not going to go forward. And this is extremely important here as we talk. I want to read the rest of this scripture. I think you'll really like it. Jesus said, your worship must engage your spirit in the pursuit of truth. That's the kind of people the Father is looking for, those who are simply and honestly themselves before Him in worship. God is sheer being itself, or spirit. Those who worship Him must do it out of their very beings, their spirits, their true selves in adoration. And again, I pose this particular question to you, that it's so necessary that we understand that we are a spirit. So let's go a little bit forward with this over to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26 and 27. God here, the very beginning of all things, the beginning of creation, it says that God spoke and said, let us make human beings in our image, make them reflecting our nature. This is the Message Bible. So they can be responsible for the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, yes, the earth itself, and every animal that moves on the face of the earth. Verse 27 is very good as well. God created human beings. He created them godlike, reflecting God's nature. He created them male and female. Now, if God is a spirit, what kind of being is God going to create? He's going to create, like Himself, a spirit being. I have to ask you a question right here and give you another example. It's a very good example. And let's just say that you've entered into some type of business personally for yourself. You're self-employed. You've given of your hard labor and time and effort, the sweat and the toil that goes into creating a wonderful business. And you've reached the place where your business is prospering and you need help. So you have to ask yourself the question, I've got to get somebody to help me, but what kind of person do I want to help me? Someone that cares about the business, but they don't have the ability, or someone that has the ability to do what I'm doing, but they don't have the heart? Or, as you can imagine, can we find somebody that not only can do the job like you can do it, but also has the heart to do it effectively as you would do it yourself? God right here is in the middle of creation, Genesis chapter 1. There is no one to turn over what God has created by creating this earth. There's no one for God to turn it over to. So God has to create someone. In essence, you could say God has the perfect scenario. He can start right from the beginning and create someone to do the job, just as well as he can do it, and who cares about it or thinks about it the way that God thinks about it. Now, if you had that opportunity, who would you create? Would you not create someone like yourself? In fact, you could say it this way. I would just create another me. So while I'm doing something else to help prosper the business, I'm still doing the basics and the fundamentals through this other me that I've created. God created someone so much like himself that Adam and Eve actually could handle the responsibilities of running the earth just as well as God could, because God made them spirits right out of his own spirit. We'll find that over in Genesis in chapter 2 and verse 7. And the Getty's translation, it says this: God breathed into his nostrils vital breath. God breathed into man's nostrils vital breath. Let's go a little further. The Amplified says, he breathed into his nostrils the breath or the spirit of life. Notice there, that is what? That's saying the same thing that we spoke earlier. You are a spirit. How did that happen? God breathed out of his spirit into you the spirit of life. The last translation is called the Fenton translation. It says this: man became a life-containing soul. Folks, this is a wonderful time for us just to get real with ourselves, for you to recognize that the person that you look at in the mirror is your flesh. God made flesh first so that he could breathe spirit into the flesh. So really, if you think about it, what is the flesh but a container? You could say it this way: the flesh is a vehicle. It's what attaches you to the earth that God made, which is of physical materiality. Come on, this is not deep here. It's very simple. There's a tangible world here that we're surrounded by at all times. This tangible world is contacted with your flesh. But your flesh is not the real you. There are other scriptures that I'm not going to put up on the screen here, but you'll find that Jesus, when he was raising up a little girl by the name of Tabitha over in Luke, raising her from the dead, she had died. It says that when he said, "Tabitha, arise," her spirit came back into her body and she got up. Which is the reason why James said, if your spirit is no longer in your body, if you're dead, that means your spirit is free from your body. Paul said it this way: to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. In other words, when your spirit is gone from this body, your body has no more life. Because the life or the breath of your body is the spirit that's living in you. This is the person on the inside. So let's say it again. You look at yourself in the mirror and you see your flesh. But the person looking out of your flesh is the real you. It's the spirit living on the inside. Let's go for a moment over to 1 Thessalonians in chapter 5. And as we look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we'll look at verse 23. It says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice the order that Paul puts this in. He says it's spirit, it's soul, and it's body. Maybe you've heard this for years, but I don't think it can be improved on. I think this is very accurate. You are a spirit. You live in a body, and you contain a soul. This is very interesting. I'll say it again. Maybe I'll say it a different way. You are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in the body. This is important for you to understand, because you need to walk around all day long being conscious of the fact that it's not your body you're responding to, it's your spirit in connection with God that you're responding to. And this is exactly what Jesus said. If you want a connection with God, if you want to worship God, if you want to have experiences with God, like we said at the very beginning, if you want to get your prayers answered, it must be that you begin to connect God out of your spirit. Your worship must engage your spirit in the pursuit of God. Jesus said, God is spirit, and they that worship God must worship in spirit and in truth. One more scripture I'm going to take you to. It's over here in 1 Peter, and it's in chapter 3, verse 3 through 5. It says, do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging of the hair, wearing of gold, putting on of fine apparel. Now, thank God for people to take care of themselves. I understand that. That the outer man does need washing. There's good hygiene that's necessary, and you need to have some clothes on. People lock you up if you don't. But what he's saying here is, don't put the emphasis of your life. In other words, give all of your energy or your value to the outward man when the inward man is who is most important. Because he finishes by saying here, Peter does, rather, let your adornment be, let your energy go to the hidden person of the heart. You say, who is the hidden person of the heart? He goes on to say, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. So notice here that it's your spirit that's in contact with God. Now, Jesus made these particular points constantly. And if you look at the life of Jesus, you'll see that everything that he did was as a spirit being connected to God instead of a flesh being connected with the world. We'll end up reiterating this particular thought here more than once throughout these sessions. But let's go back for just a moment to Adam and Eve in the garden. When God breathed into their nostrils the breath of life, he put spirit inside of those physical bodies. Adam and Eve began to walk and began to talk and began to fellowship with God. We're going to look at this in the next session. They began to fellowship with God out of their spirit. And this is what Jesus came to do. Jesus was called over in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, and verse 45, he was called the last Adam. So he came on the earth to do what? To correct everything that Adam messed up and to show everyone what it looked like to walk around with a connection out of his spirit with God. So that everything that Adam did out of a relationship. Everything that Jesus did also out of a relationship. Now, let me give you one idea here, and this will help you as we go on, and it'll help you to begin to think of these things early on so that our progression in the next sessions will begin to help you to make a connection with God as well. Let me just stop right now and say this. It's possible that in your life you find yourself very frustrated. And if you're frustrated, it goes back even to my wife and I, beginning during those early childhood years with our daughters, realizing that if we frustrate our children, it's because we're actually putting a legalistic type of mentality into them. We're lording over them without having the relationship. And that was something very early on, and even to this day, we protect with all our heart. You say, why do you protect this? We protect it because the most important part of who you are is your heart. You as a spirit in connection with God. Not the legalistic things that you're told that you have to do or the things that you're reminded that you shouldn't do, but you having a connection that's real from your heart. Well, this is what Jesus did on a regular basis. Let me give you one example of this. Jesus would constantly and regularly yield to his spirit when he could have yielded to his flesh. Let me give you one example of this real quickly. Jesus and Peter were talking and they were discussing some things about paying taxes and about money. Now, if you don't know this, I'll just quickly give you this as information. Jesus had his own treasurer by the name of Judas. Judas didn't actually end up having a good life, but nonetheless, during those days when he was with Jesus, he took care of the money, counting the money, keeping the money in a treasury. Well, Jesus had more than enough money. He could have turned to Judas and said, Judas, flip me a couple of those coins that are in your pocket. Judas might have looked at him and said, Lord, how do you know they're in my pocket? Well, Judas was known for taking money out of the treasury and putting it in his pocket and using it himself. So Jesus could easily have just said, Judas, flip me a couple of coins. And you ask yourself the question, would that have been all right? And of course it would have been all right. The only thing is, Jesus came here to establish something, and that is, what does it look like to live life on the earth in flesh, but live life out of your spirit? And what Jesus did next was, he told Simon Peter, he said, go fishing, and the first fish you catch, it will have 2 gold coins in its mouth. Pay my tax and pay your tax. Say, why did Jesus do this? Because everything that he did was to restore man back to a spiritual connection with God. Man lost his way and connected with his flesh to the world. Folks, that's where frustration comes, when your flesh is connected to the world instead of your spirit being connected to God. When Jesus said this, I'm telling you what, because Jesus and Adam were given the authority, we've already read that over in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 27 and 26, that God gave man authority over the birds of the air, the beasts of the field, and the fish of the sea. When Jesus spoke that out of his mouth, those words caused a little fish to go down, and he caught a couple of coins and then went to the surface to look for Peter's fish hook. I know you may think that's stretching it, but that's exactly what happened, because that's the power of connecting with God out of your spirit. There's nothing impossible. All things are possible with God when people are engaging their spirit in the pursuit of worship. And now I give you my last illustration here to end this particular first session, because I want you to leave this session here constantly feeding yourself the information that you've been given. I am a spirit being. I'm not flesh. My flesh is connected to the world, but that's not how I bring judgment. That's not how I make decisions. I make choices out of my spirit connected to God. You must begin to change the way you see your life. Change the way your reality is, from your reality being, what can I do? I don't know what to do. I wonder who I can ask about this crisis in my life to. I am connected to God, and if I engage my spirit in the pursuit of worship, there's nothing that God can't do through my life. All right, here's my last illustration. I assume that I'm speaking to many of you here today, but you can all understand this if you don't own an automobile. But I assume I'm speaking to many of you that actually do own an automobile, or you would say a car, a vehicle. So I'll ask you the question. Are you an automobile? Are you a car? And you would say, well, no, I'm a human being. All right, very well said. But do you own a car? Yes, I own a car. But you're not a car. No, I'm not a car. The next question is where we want to get to. Does your car drive you, or do you drive your car? And some of us say, well, I drive my car, of course. And then I'd ask you this question. Would it be very dangerous for you if you took your car up on top of a very large hill that had a 90-degree turn at the bottom? Of course, I'm making this up. And it had a huge oak tree at the very bottom of that hill. And you took your hands off the steering wheel, you took your feet off the brake, and you engaged the car, and you went ahead and went down that hill. Would it be a very dangerous thing for you and the car, when most likely the car's not going to be able to make the turn on its own? And you head right into what? A big oak tree. And you say, of course, we'd have a collision, and it would be dangerous for me, and it would ruin the car. So that it would be better than if you went ahead and had your hands on the steering wheel, your feet on the brake, or controlling the gas pedal and brake, and you driving the car. All I've done is take 30 to 40 seconds, maybe 1 minute, to explain to you the whole lesson that we've just given you. You may be thinking, well, this is just so simple. It's all simple, folks. It has to be simple, and this is one of the greatest errors that we've missed. It's so simple that we've gone on to explaining things in such theological nonsense, trapping people in all kinds of religious bondage. And folks, if you don't really believe what I'm saying, all you got to do is go back to past history and see that for thousands of generations, people have been muddying the water, have been confusing the simplistic approach of the message of Christ, to the point where people are doing everything that they can do to find God and yet very rarely finding Him. Come on, there has to be something wrong. It has to be simple. So what I'm explaining to you is this. The car is your body. You are the spirit. And you need to drive your car. Don't let your car drive you. That means you need to be aware that you are not the car. In other words, being aware that your body is not the real you. Your body is just the tag-along. It's just the vehicle. In other words, when God's in the garden, and Adam and Eve are in the garden, and they're fellowshipping with one another, if God said, Adam, I'll meet you tomorrow at, let's just say, 8 o'clock, And God said, let's meet in the southwest corner. How was Adam going to get there? He used his body as a vehicle to walk to the southwest corner, and he began to fellowship with God out of his spirit. Folks, this is so important that you take this lesson, this first lesson, and literally begin to surround your mind with these thoughts. Change the way you see yourself. I know this may sound a little bit strange to you. You don't have to let other people hear you, but constantly talk to yourself and remind yourself, I am a spirit connected to God. I am not flesh connected to the world. Because you need to be in that frame of mind for whatever takes place in your life, for being able to make wise choices of your spirit that allows God to be real in your life. This is one of the first things you need to know. I am a spirit being. I've been made in the image and likeness of God, and I have every right to contact God out of my spirit and fellowship with my Father. It must be the most normal experience of life. And this is where we'll stop today. And we're going to pick up with session number 2. I believe you're really going to enjoy it. It's going to help move you to a place where experiencing God should be what you expect all day long. Thanks for being with us.